at home,
on your smartphone,
in your car,
at work,
at home,
on your smartphone.
Hi everyone, it's your girl BB Clement, the author of How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur and the host of your weekly business show, BB Means Business, the show where we discuss everything you ever wanted to know about business but you were afraid to ask. How do I start my business? How do I raise the finance? How do I grow my business? Where am I going to find my customers? Join me every Tuesday at 1:30 p.m. on Star Radio UK to get all the information and tips that you need to become a successful entrepreneur and become financially free. Remember, don't let life dictate to you. Rather, put your signature on life.
Get ready for this.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Our utmost apologies for the late start of this program. We've got gremlins in the system, as often happens when you're dependent on technology. I'm your host, BB Clement, and you are very, very welcome once again to the BB Means Business Show, your weekly show where you get your dose of information, education, advice, assistance, anything and everything you need to know about business and helping you on your journey to become financially free. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, I'm your host, BB Clement. And this, again, is the BB Means Business Show. I run a group of successful small companies. I'm also the author of How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur. Which you can purchase on Amazon, on my website. And my website address is www.bbclement.com. All right. Now, something that we started doing last week. Bear with me, guys. All right. I'm going to fire my producer after this. Let's go. Hi everyone, it's your girl BB Clement, the author of How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur and the host of your weekly business show, BB Means Business, the show where we discuss everything you ever wanted to know about business but you were afraid to ask. How do I start my business? How do I raise the finance? How do I grow my business? Where am I going to find my customers? Join me every Tuesday at 1:30 p.m. on Star Radio UK to get all the information and tips that you need to become a successful entrepreneur and become financially free. Remember, don't let life dictate to you. Rather, put your signature on life.
Get ready for this.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's your host, BB Clement, and you are welcome once again to the BB Means Business Show. First of all, utmost apologies for the late start of the show. We're having some technical problems down here, as often happens when you're dependent on technology. But we're good to go, and we're really excited about today's show. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, I'm your host, BB Clement, and this show is called BB Means Business, and this is where you come when you need all the information, education, advice, and knowledge on anything and everything to do with business that can help you on your entrepreneurial journey and also help you in your quest to become financially free. Because at the end of the day, that's what we're here for. We're here so that we can become financially free. Okay, so I'm also the author of How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur, details of which you should see on the bottom hand of your screen. And you can purchase that book from my website, www.bbclements.com, or you can buy it on Amazon for $12.99 plus postage payments as well. Okay, so one of the things that me and my team decided to do is every quarter we were going to do a rerun of the show that was voted the highest watched show, or the one that people really enjoyed and they wanted to hear again. So that's what we did last week. Last week we did a rerun, and the show that we did last week was Your Network Determines Your Net Worth. So I hope you enjoyed that, and thank you for those of you who voted that your most favorite show. But the week prior to that, I had the honor of having a very special guest on the show, who was none other than my husband, Mr. Shay Clement. And Shay is a dual qualified solicitor, award winning as well. And he was on the show talking to us about the different kind of business structures that are available. And it's really important, and I'm going to emphasize that again, it's really important that you get your business structure right, because failure to do so makes a difference between whether you are successful in business or whether the whole thing collapses along the way. So some of the things that we looked at the sole business structure, we looked at the partnership, we looked at the limited company, that kind of thing. Just wanted to do to highlight a couple of tips that he gave us in relation to the sole trader, and the reasons why that is the most popular structure in the UK. And one of the reasons is because really you don't need a lot of money and it doesn't have a lot of fuss. So literally, once you've got your bank account, you've got your business name, and you've informed HMRC, you're pretty much good to go. So you can literally be someone like BB Clement trading as Clement Consulting. And once you've informed HMRC, you can go, and then you start building your structure around it, your website, your marketing, and all the other things. But one of the advantages of being a sole practitioner is, one, because there's nobody else to consult, or oftentimes there's nobody else to consult, you can make decisions very, very quickly, which is really important for those times when you have those gut instincts, and everybody has them in business, when you just, you know, maybe the circumstances are not right, but something inside you is saying, I got to jump, and I've got to jump now. And so being a sole trader can be really good for that, because you don't have a whole committee that has to discuss it and then review it and then decide. You can just jump into whatever it is that you want to do. So that's one of the advantages of being a sole practitioner. We also looked at the advantages and the disadvantages of having a partnership structure. And one of the advantages was that, of course, you have a wider pool of services that you can offer your clients. So, for instance, let's say it's a law firm and I specialize in employment law. One of the other partners might specialize in immigration law. Somebody else might specialize in family law. So we have a wider pool of services that we're able to offer clients if you have a partnership. Also, those times where things go wrong, you all share the responsibility, you share the all the things that need to be done, so you don't literally have to be tied to your desk all the time. You can go on holiday and somebody else can hold the fort. So those are some of the things that we learned on that particular program. But today we're doing something slightly different. For those of you who live in the UK, I know you're watching from all over the world, which reminds me, I want to say a big shout out to all my USA guys. Hi, thank you so much for tuning in. And all the guys that watch from South Africa and Kenya, there's an increasing number of you that do that. Really grateful. Thank you for tuning in. We really are grateful for you doing so. And I'm glad that it's making a difference to you all the way in South Africa. So yes, as you know, the world is now a global village, so it's important that we all hook up and we all learn from each other. So, but if you live in the UK, you will know that every October is Black History Month. And so I thought it'd be nice if during this month we could highlight successful Black-owned businesses, because it's not easy being a Black entrepreneur in the UK. And so I chose some businesses that I know are doing well, and I want them to share their journey with you. And so it gives me the utmost honor to have on the show today two very successful women. Yes, they're women. And I have on the show Cynthia Akinsoya. Cynthia, are you there?
Hi there.
Hi. And Toyono Bo, are you there as well?
I'm here. Hello.
Okay. Welcome, both of you, to the show. I'm really glad that you guys could make it. Thank you for taking time out of what I know is your very busy schedules for being here. But I know it's going to be worth the while of our listeners to hear from you about your entrepreneurial journey. Okay, Cynthia, do you want to go first? Just tell us a little bit about who you are and what you do and how you got into doing what you do.
Okay, first of all, thank you so much for inviting me on. It's really great to be part of the show and also part of Black History Month. So I run a cake business. My business is called Delights by Cynthia. I've been running the business for 15 years and I create cakes for individuals, for corporate events, for weddings, celebrations, you name it. If you need a cake, I can make a cake for you.
Okay, good to know. So what do you do? You do something totally different.
Yes. So I run an editing business. So we edit books, manuscripts, essays, you know, everything to do with writing. I have been doing this since, I would say 2007 is when I actually started doing it, you know, as you do it as a hobby. But I started it as a business in 2016. So basically anything you need doing with your books, send it our way. We will look after it for you.
Okay, cool. All right. I need to say at this point that Toyin is actually my editor. So if you've ever read the book, How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur, she's one of the reasons why that book is selling so well. So yes, I can highly recommend her. So ladies, I want to just discuss certain things. One of the things that my listeners are interested in is making that journey from being an employee to going into business. So Cynthia, could you just share, because I know this was not your background, so can you just share with us what was your professional background? What was your journey into going into business? And why did you decide to go into business for yourself?
Okay, so I've worn several hats, but I suppose the two main ones were my background is journalism. I spent a number of years as a features writer for Hair and Beauty magazine. And then I kind of morphed into working in marketing and communications, but basically from a not-for-profit sector. And I think the thing is that when you're working from your day job into your business, think about the skills that you can transfer from one into the other. And I think that there are things that I, as a journalist, you know, you still have to write about your product. As a marketing and communication expert, you still have to bring those skills into your business.
How are those skills? Because I mean, there's a far distance from being a journalist and making cakes. What skills specifically did you bring from your journalism background?
Okay, so definitely writing. So for instance, if I'm writing any content on social media, I think about how I'm talking to my audience, thinking about what will resonate with them, what will they be interested in. So bringing that skill as a journalist, creating content on social media. And then also in terms of marketing and public relations, because of being a journalist in the past, I know how busy they are. I know that they don't have a lot of time. So I know how to communicate with them in terms of pitching a story, in terms of achieving media coverage for the business. So it's almost like a reflection of what I was doing in the past.
Interesting. One of the things that you said that I think is really important for those of us who are in business, particularly when it comes to our marketing and our social media, oftentimes people put they put information about their business out there that resonates with them, as opposed to what would resonate with their clients. And that's there's a huge difference. And I think that's a huge mistake. Some people will say, well, this is not what I would like to read. Well, that's the whole point. It's not about you. It's about your clients. And one of the things that I'm really emphatic about is ensuring that you are speaking to your clients in the language that they understand. Well, do you have any views on that, Cynthia?
Definitely. The thing is that sometimes from when you start your business, you might have an idea of a market or a set of people that you would want to attract. And then as your business grows and evolves, it may be that you have a different client group and you have to talk to your client in the language that they will understand. So a very quick example I will give you is that sometimes I have clients that work in the city. They tend to be men who have forgotten that it's their wife's birthday or anniversary, and they need a solution to their problem. So the language that I will speak to them will be quick and succinct with providing them with the information that they need so that they can make a decision. Am I going to order a cake from this lady? So that's one example.
Wow, I love that. Actually. I love that. I think that's really good. Yeah, interesting. Okay, Sorin, do you want to share your journey with it? How did you get into what you're doing now?
Okay, I mean, more or less the same. My background is in HR, actually. So I did work, I worked for a couple of civil service organizations here. And then I got the itch to write around about 2006, I think. I decided I wanted to write a novel. And I got, I got writing, I wrote my first novel. And then they were offering redundancies around about the same time. And I thought, oh, do you know what? I'm going to be an author. So I went away and took the redundancy package and sat down and wrote. And then when I finished this, my baby novel, I thought I'm going to do justice to it. And I'm going to sign up for Amazon's package that included editing. So it went off to an editor, and when it came back, I almost cried because I had spent so much time doing this, editing this baby of mine, and he just took his red pen and shredded the whole thing. And, I couldn't, it took me ages to be able to recover from that. But after I finished and I calmed down and I read it, I thought, oh my goodness, my book is going to be so much more readable because of the work that this guy has put into it. And then, I just carried on, and gradually, as I was doing my editing, I was doing my work, I started to notice that I could help out a friend here or help out a friend there. And then over time, people actually started to pay me to edit their books. And I thought, oh, wow, this is something I can do alongside my own writing. And so I've just honed my skills from there, really. So, over time, UBB came along, and I've worked with lots of different clients, just putting their book to rights, basically, as best as I can. Yeah.
Cool. Okay. I'm having a bit of a coughing fit here, so if I disappear, that's what I've gone to do. So just keep talking. Okay. Right. The next question. I'd like to talk about Cynthia. I'm going to address this question to you because I've known you for many, many, many years, and even before you started doing cakes on a professional level, you were very, very passionate about cakes. Very passionate. What role do you think passion plays in being successful in business?
I think passion is the core thread that runs through everything that you do, or it should be, because if you're not passionate about the product or the service that you are offering to people, there will be times that you will almost be resentful. When you're passionate about something, it will keep you awake late at night because you're thinking about it. And it will also get you out of bed in the morning because it's the thing that you want to do. So if you're not passionate about it, it's going to be very hard to sort of propel your business forward.
Okay. Sorry, any views on that?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm just thinking about this morning. I've been at my desk since 6:30 because I have a manuscript that I've got to get back to an author, and I have a day job as well. So I'm thinking I have to, I have to slice the time. Yeah. So yes, I've been here. Passion is so important. There will be times when your motivation might be a bit, here and there, but the passion for what you do, for me as an editor, my desire to see every single book that comes away from our business, in Amazon, in the stores, makes me put in my best. And of course, what that then does is the client that you're working with sees that, and they are willing, they'll come back. I can't count the number of clients that have come back based on, that relationship where I'm almost loving their book more than they are. it's that kind of thing. Yeah. So okay. I do agree.
All right. I'm not going to, just to let the viewers know, normally we take a break around now, but I'm not doing a break today because we started late. I just want to power through. But I do want to use this opportunity to do a shout out to all my Ado members. Hi, Ado, from all over the world. Thank you so much for your faithfulness in tuning in. Also want to give a shout out to Paul Jones. Thank you so much for all the promotion that you do for the show. We're really grateful that you joined, and I hope you're getting a lot out of it. Okay, ladies, you were telling me you guys have been at your desk since 6:30. I've got to get up earlier. I've got to start getting up earlier. This is not on. Look at my fellow entrepreneurs. They're at their desk.
Needs must be.
Has to.
All right, I want to talk about something a bit more specific to the UK now, if you don't mind. Now, one of the problems, or one of the greatest issues that Black-owned businesses tell me about, is the issue of funding. Has funding been a problem, or is this an imaginary thing? Cynthia, you want to go?
I've steered clear of sourcing funding just because I know the hurdles that people have had to jump through as a Black business to secure funding. You're probably more likely to be given a loan to buy a car than you are for a business. I know that things have changed over the last year or so, particularly with the backdrop of COVID, but I just think that there's more pride and also more of a initiative if you are self-financed. I know that that's not always the case for other businesses, particularly if they're sort of doing things on a larger scale, but I've always steered clear of any funding or finance.
Okay. I think that's, like you said, that's probably more possible for you because you are a sole trader.
Yes.
So I agree that if you have a larger kind of business, that might not be possible. But Toyin, what are your views on the whole funding thing?
Well, I'm in a similar position to Cynthia in that obviously editing is about sitting at your desk and, you know, doing the work, and the client kind of helps you generate the funding that way. But we are now looking at we're looking at expanding our business to being a full publishing cohort, which means we're going to need to maybe look at taking on some people to work with us or for us as time goes on. So it's a world I'm going to delve into, and we're doing our business plans and things like that to be able to see what the funding we might be able to get. I'm not, to a large extent, I'm of the view that if I haven't experienced it, then I can't really speak to it.
Yeah.
But I also believe that if I do need the funds, then I will be, do my Christian faith here, I will know where to go in that sense, because I will maybe do my research or definitely know where, you know, because sometimes it's about where you go for funding. Some people, you know, I know of this, some people will do crowdfunding because that's what they need, or that's what will get them what they need. And sometimes your passion will sell that. So it's about knowing where to go, which I am in the process of discovering. And then being persistent, I think, as well, for me. I think persistence, I won't be prepared to just, you know, take the first two no's that come my way and think, oh, they're not going to give me funding because of this. I will make sure that I'm actually, you know, they want to fund my business because of the value that I'm bringing by my business. So that's going to be my attitude. But then again, like I said, I haven't actually really treaded that route a lot.
Okay. Now, I think some of the points that you raised are quite important. One, you knowing the value of what you're bringing is very, very important, because really that's what investors are interested in, that you understand what it is that you're bringing and why your clients would need what it is that you're bringing. And if you don't know the value, you won't know why they're even hiring you. So that's one thing. Two, also you were talking about writing a business plan. I think I know not everybody has one, but I think it's important. Even if you don't have, you know, the really professional ones where it almost looks like, you know, sometimes they're just so elaborate. But even if it's just a matter of writing your ideas down in a logical way that people can, you know, potential investors can have a look at and see. But I think it's important that you do that even for your own purposes, so once you've got it done on paper, even you begin to see what works and what doesn't work, yeah, what seems, you know, silly and what needs tweaking, that kind of thing. So I think getting your house in order before you pitch for investors is very, very important. Don't just think that because it sounds like a good idea to you that the whole world is going to agree with you that it's going to be a good idea, because it doesn't work that way. So that's quite important. All right, I want to ask a question that not just relates to race or being Black, but also slightly further to do with our culture, particularly as you're both women. Do you feel that your business has impacted on your family in a negative way because you are Black women and there's certain expectations of Black women, or you do not feel that way at all? Sorry, you want to go first?
In terms of, but I'm not sure about it being because I'm a Black woman. On the flip side, we are quite, well, I would say we are known to be quite industrious. So we will be the ones doing six businesses at the same time. And I know how many hats I wear. I was just thinking about this, that in terms of life balance, I know how many hats I wear. And sometimes that can impact on, you know, what's going on at home. And again, I think I have to take full responsibility for where I am in life. So if I find that things are falling down because I am trying to be the wife and the mother and the business this, and, you know, I'm running all these businesses I'm running, I need to check, you know, I need to check that my, you know, what I'm doing is not adversely affecting my home, because my home is, you know, it's so important. If eventually that falls apart, then it does impact on the business. I know of times when things haven't been going right at home and I've not been able to think straight to do my business because I haven't looked after the home. And I don't mean I haven't cleaned my home. I'm not the most domesticated person, please don't think that. But there are things you still have the responsibility to look after at home. So in that sense, for me, I wouldn't say it's to do with being, if anything, it's just that I'm always doing so many things. And my friends would say, how are you doing all those things? It's a DNA thing to a certain extent, but also it's about, as you say, financial freedom. I don't want the day when, you know, we want to provide for our children's children, and to be able to do that, sometimes you have to wear more than one hat, unless you want to work in the city or something. Anyway, but at the end of the day, I have to own how I you know, how I'm making sure that I'm balancing everything I'm doing, because it's important for me.
Yeah, I agree. I've adopted Mary Kay's philosophy, and her philosophy was God first, family second, business third. Absolutely. And that's pretty much the way I see it. As much as I love the whole entrepreneurial thing, for me, it means nothing if my family falls apart.
Yes.
So I don't know if that's a cultural thing or if that's a faith thing or whatever. I don't know. But for me, it's just a priority thing that my family comes first. Cynthia, any thoughts?
Yeah, I totally agree with what both of you have said. And I think that it's about having order and balance. And possibly one of the reasons why Toyin and I are up at 6 in the morning is everybody else is asleep.
Asleep, absolutely.
Things done. So I think that I think also if you're running your business from your home as well, you have to remember that, you know, sometimes the area that you use that is your office may also be the area that your children may do their homework.
Yes.
Or, you know, there are times of the day where you just have to stop doing things related to the business and then connect with your children or with your husband. So it's about balance and order. And I think that as women of colour, I think that we do, you know, we're driven. I'm not saying that other women aren't, but I think that, you know, we're driven, we want to be good examples for our children. And so therefore, these are probably one of the reasons that we do wear several hats. But it's about managing your time as well. It's really important that although you're really, really busy, that maybe one or two days in the year that you just take time out just for yourself. Mm-hmm. So I would encourage women to incorporate that as in even into your business plan.
Okay. All right.
I love that. Yes.
Okay. Now, I was thinking the other day about this, and I've spoken about this on the show as well, about embeddedness. And embeddedness occurs when you are dependent upon your own people group for patronage of your product. And I'm of the strong belief that if we want our businesses to grow rather than them stay small, which tends to be the norm in the Black community, our businesses tend to stay small. But if you want them to grow, I'm a strong believer that you have to overcome embeddedness. You have to get past your own people group. Cynthia, what are your thoughts on this? Do you feel that your business model appeals to non-Africans? Have you had to do anything have you had to do anything in a proactive way to make that happen, or has that just happened automatically?
Okay, well, I'm blessed.
Or is it not a problem at all?
Okay, well, I'm blessed in the fact that everybody likes cake. So cake isn't, you know, cake isn't bound by race or gender or, you know, ethnicity. Everybody likes cake. So that's, you know, the first starting point. One of the things I make sure with my branding and even on the website, my face is on there. So you know already that I'm a woman of colour, and it's up to you whether you decide to come to me or not. The other element is that as a, yes, I am a black business, but I don't specifically do my marketing and communication to one people group. And I think that's really, really important. And particularly in the UK, you know, the African Caribbean population makes up, I think, something like 6 to 10% of the population. Yes. So just doing a business just for that people group, you are missing out on so many other customers, so many other clients. So I think the thing is just to remain professional in all that you do. I think that you will also find that there are some people that think, well, because you are a black business, therefore you are going to do things on the cheap. I think that your product and what you do needs to speak volumes to those people. And I think if you value what you will do, what you do, there will be some people that will be drawn to you, and then other people will, you know, either because of finances or because of their expectation, they will go somewhere else. And I think it's about setting your stall out to show, this is what I do, this is the value, and is this something that you want?
Okay, I think what you said there is interesting, because I know a number of black-owned companies that actually don't feel confident in pitching to people outside their own community. I'm not sure why that is. Toyin, any thoughts on that?
I wouldn't know why that is either, because I wouldn't have a problem pitching my services to anybody, because everybody reads books. Yeah. So for me, as far as I'm concerned, my book, my goal is to make sure that my book, every day I walk past Tesco and I think, this novel or this person's book, one day it will be sold in Tesco. And that's like the lowest denominator. If your book is available in Tesco, it's already been through Waterstones and, you know, all those other places. And so anybody, you know, and again, in, I suppose in our, in the publishing industry, that we can tell stories in a way, if I'm talking about fiction now, you know, people like Chimamanda Adichie, people love to read books by her. But for me to be able to, my job is to get my clients' books to read in such a delightful way that anybody would want to. And then that's got nothing to do with your color. It's got to do with your voice. It's got to do with the story you have to tell. And for me, that's my, you know, that's my priority. So when I'm looking at your book, for instance, I'm not going to go and look at, regardless of what, where you're from, I'm looking at your genre. I'm looking at the things that matter in the industry, not, you know, how can you tell your story in such a way that anybody will read it? And if you have that in your mind, then anybody will read your book. If it's a children's book, write, you know, don't just write to children, I don't know, of color. Write a book that any child will want to pick up. In fact, write a book that a mom will want to read with their child. That's the, you know, that's the way, that's the broad way I talk to my clients about writing.
Yes, I agree with both of you. I do also think, though, that sometimes because we feel within our own people group, I don't know if you've experienced this or not, but this has sometimes been my experience, because we sometimes feel that within our own people group, certain things do not matter, especially when it comes to things like shops and stuff like that. I'll give an example. There's a street near my house where a couple of years ago I did some market research. I was watching the types of shops that were on that street. It's a commercial street, so practically every house is a shop, or every building is a shop. And there are different ethnic owned groups. So we have the Eastern Europeans, they have a couple of shops there. We have Asians who have a couple of takeaways. We have a Chinese takeaway. We have a number of Nigerian hairdressers and beauty salons and things like that. So I did quite a bit of research, and I was watching their behavior the way the shop is organized, the way they sell, their customer service. I was doing that for about 6 months and taking notes. And I found a lot of interesting stuff that I think made me a bit, I don't know whether to say nervous, but made me a bit uncomfortable. So for instance, none of the black owned shops were ever open before 10 o'clock. That was number one. Well, that for me is an issue. I don't know how you ladies feel about what I'm saying, because you're looking a bit uncomfortable, but I haven't finished yet.
No.
So none of them, I tried this for about 6 month period, none of them were ever open before 10 o'clock. That was one. And these were people that were selling things that they needed that early morning foot trade, you know. Two, I would look at the way the shop is designed. So there's one particular shop that comes to mind. I'd go into the shop, there was a lino on the floor, which is fine, there's not a problem with that. But the lino was often ripped in different places, tattered and ripped in different places. Oftentimes when you're looking at the shop window, the curb appeal was not great. The signage, one particular shop I can think of, the signage was done by hand and wasn't done very well. And then I remember looking at one particular shop and I had no idea what it was they sold. By looking through the window, I didn't know what the shop sold because there was just so much. There was weave on in one bit. There was calling cards in another bit. There was food and whatever being advertised in another bit. And I remember walking into one particular shop, and I'm stating this so that those who are listening and are black owners can take note and do something about it. I remember going into one shop and the lady sold food. And I wanted to buy bread. I wanted to buy, you know, the African bread, the really thick one, what we call agege bread, the really thick one. Mm-hmm. And I went in there and as I was about to take the bread off the shelf, I could see rat droppings all around. Oh. And I spoke to her about it, and she was just very blasé about it. I mean, she didn't think it was that big a deal. These kind of things I do not see, I've got to be honest, I do not see in other ethnic-owned businesses. And I feel that if we are going to make our businesses grow, these are things that we have to start doing something about. What are your views, ladies?
Well, that last one was definitely a no-brainer. No matter what shop I went into, I would never expect to find rat droppings with food. That's just, you know, I would be calling, you know, the people who would come and do something about that particular shop. But I hear what you're saying, and this is all about really... professionalism is really the word that we're looking for here. And to a certain extent, I think this is where you're saying about the clientele that we're looking for, because generally, if I'm buying my plantain and I'm buying my, you know, my yam or whatever, I'm just going to dash into this store. I know exactly what I'm getting and I'm going to dash out. But that doesn't speak, that's not going to help that particular business owner, because my next door neighbor, who is not, who is not black, will like the dodo when I fry it, and I can say to that person, oh, you could get it from so and so store, but I would never say that, because I would never advertise that particular business. So it's something that we do need to think about, competitiveness, you know, even to things like your website, for example. You go onto certain websites and you can't see the wood for the trees, and then you go to the next website and everything is, as you know, it's drawing the customer. So your shop front, whether it is online or, you know, in store, has to be drawing your customers in. That's what I would say.
Mm. Yeah, I totally agree. I think the two things are customer service and professionalism. Even if you're running your business from home, you know, make sure that you do things legally, above board, with utmost professionalism. So for instance, with me, if somebody wants a cake and they're coming at 11 o'clock, I do not need to be in my nightie at 5 to 11 when they're about to ring the door. You know, I need to be up, ready, have that cake packaged. Every, you know, give it's about giving your customer a good experience.
Yes.
So even though you're handing over a cake that will be used for a birthday or a celebration, the whole thing from the phone call or the email that they call you and say, I need a cake for Jack's birthday next week, you are professional all the way along the line. So whether you have a shop front, whether you're working from home, and I think one of the things, Toya, and I'm sure you'll back me up, particularly with your editor's hat, when you're writing something, read it again. Typos can be the end of you. So really make sure that, you know, you're using the correct grammar. And if that's not your area of expertise, find somebody that is. You can't be all things to all men, but it's about being as professional as possible.
Yeah. I agree totally. So I think the message for those of you who are watching, the message is excellence should be a standard in our businesses.
Absolutely.
It should be a standard. That's what we've got to aim for. The whole shoddy, oh, let's just manage it, that's mindset. That's got to go. If we want our businesses to do well, that has got to go. Excellence should be a standard. And like Cynthia said, you see, we no longer have, one of the things I said in one of my recent shows was that consumerism, which is really what's happening now, consumerism is almost a religion. And so the client no longer just wants to make a purchase. They want an experience. They want a memorable experience. And so it is your job as an entrepreneur to ensure that they get that. And just like Cynthia said, from the minute they begin to interact with you, whether it's on your website, whether it's the way you pick up the phone, whether it's the fact that the work is ready on time, their whole experience should be one of excellence when they come into contact with you. Okay. All right. Now, I want to talk about this. I was reading something today, and they were saying that 95% of our purchasing power, the black community in the UK, 95% of our purchasing power or practice is spent outside our community. 95%. I found that quite alarming. Mm-hmm. What do you either of you think we can do to encourage people to buy black?
I think continue to be professional, continue to almost dispel the myths that people may have about black businesses. And I think as well, I know particularly for me with a cake business, I will get customers that you will come up with several ideas for them for the birthday cake that they need next week. And then they will say, well, my aunt can make it. And I get that. I get that their aunt can make it. But if you want, you know, go ahead and ask your aunt to make the cake. But if you want something that's quite specific, a bespoke cake, then also I think recognize the value of it and be prepared to pay for it. There is, I think, is it 24 billion that the black economy churns out in the UK? And so there is disposable income, there is money. And I think it's just a matter of what black people choose to spend their money on or what they value as a good product and a good service. And I think it's just for us to continue to encourage people to say, we're out here, we're doing great things, and come and buy from us.
Yeah. All right. Listeners, I hope you heard that. I'd like to set you a challenge for this coming week, that you will be proactive in buying black. I think the figure is actually you said 24 billion.
I can come back.
I think it's gone up to 30 billion. It's about 30 billion our disposable income, the amount that we spend. And only 5% of that is staying in our community. That is a tragedy. Mm. So I'm going to set my viewers a challenge that this week you will proactively make the decision to buy black and keep that money within our community. It's really important that we begin to do this. This is how the Jewish community has prospered. Mm. So we've got to take a leaf out of their book and make sure that we begin to do this. Buy black if you can. There are, just like Cynthia said, there are some of us that are doing great things. So it's not an excuse. You can get businesses that are doing, black-owned businesses that are doing great things. So just seek them out. Seek out those with a good reputation and do what you can to buy black. Torin, can I just quickly come to you? What would you say have been your challenges? And this is real quick. What would you say have been your challenges as a black business owner?
I think for me, obviously, at the level I'm at, it is being able to organize my business in such a way that I am reaching more people. So for me, I because I am an editor first and foremost, I may not have my business hat on more often than I ought to, because I'm first and foremost a businesswoman. So I should be working on my business every single day, even if it is something small. And I know that that is what will grow my business. So, but because I am wearing all these hats and I need to take some of them off, I think that can be an issue for me. So the challenge is motivating myself, making sure that I'm working on my business to grow my business across the board, because I have said all the right things here in terms of anybody can read a book. So I need to find where they are and pitch myself to them in the right ways. So that will be a personal one for me.
Okay, Cynthia, what successes have you had? What would you say has been the highlight of your entrepreneurial journey?
I've still got a long way to go, but I think for me, investing in the business, investing in a 10-day cordon bleu course, ooh, where it just opened my eyes to doing things with even more of a spirit of excellence, learning how the professionals do things. So for me, that those 10 days, I mean, it nearly killed me, because it was we were in the kitchens at sort of bang on 8, and again, it's this whole thing about, you know, if you weren't punctual, they started without you, because the people that were teaching you, they've got their qualification, they've got their accreditation, so they're being paid because we'd already paid for the course. So I think for me, those 10 days learning, skills and tips regarding cake decorating and experimenting with ingredients, it just helped me to take my business up to the next level. But again, I've still got a long way to go.
Okay. All right. Just before we round up, I want to do a quick shout out to Mfo Dindi, who is in South Africa. Mfo, thank you very much for joining us again today. Much obliged. Ladies, can you just let us know where our viewers can get a hold of you if they have a book or a manuscript that it needs editing, or they need to order a cake? Real quick, where can we get hold of you online?
Okay, so if you would like your book edited, my website address is www.heritageediting.co.uk, and it's two E's, heritageediting.co.uk.
Okay, all right, I think the details of that are going to go up. My producer's putting them up on as we speak. Cynthia, you want to go?
Yeah, you can find me on www.delightsbycynthia.com, and I'm on Instagram and Facebook and Twitter, and I'd love to hear from you.
Okay. Well, that brings us to the end of the program. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again for tuning in this week. I hope you enjoyed it. I want to thank my guests, Toyona Bowe and Cynthia Akisanya. Thank you very much. And indeed, I wish you both every success with your businesses. I wish you lots of growth, lots of prosperity. Girls, do me a favor. When you get up in the morning, you might want to give your girl a call, because clearly I'm liking you. So,
thanks for having me, Vivi. It's really been fun.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
All right. To all our viewers, I'll be here again same time next week. And we have two other companies that we're going to review. They're going to be guys this time. And we're going to be looking at them as well as part of celebration of Black History Month. Remember what I said. Go out, buy black, spend your money, keep your money within the community. Stay safe with all the things, all the rules that we're having in relation to COVID. Stay safe, please, because I want to see you here again next week. And remember, don't let life dictate to you. Rather, put your signature on life. Bye-bye.
Hi, everyone. It's your girl, BB Clement, the author of How to Go From Employee to Entrepreneur and the host of your weekly business show, BB Means Business, the show where we discuss everything you ever wanted to know about business, but you were afraid to ask. How do I start my business? How do I raise the finance? How do I grow my business? Where am I going to find my customers? Join me every Tuesday at 1:30 p.m. on Star Radio UK to get all the information and tips that you need to become a successful entrepreneur and become financially free. Remember, don't let life dictate to you. rather put your signature on life.